Today for Gaule's question time, I've got the pleasure of being joined by Richard Kestenbaum from Triangle Capital. Hi, Richard.
Hi, Andrew. It's great to be with you, and thank you so much for having me.
Great. Well, we spoke a few weeks back, and I was thought that what you were speaking about how companies get to the point of having a point of liquidity, doing M&A, changing their sort of structures would be a great area to cover. And you're quite a prolific writer in Forbes on things like retail and AI. So I want to explore those areas first. But if you could kick off and talk about yourself and what you do at Triangle Capital, please.
Sure. So what we do here is mergers and acquisitions. And that's typically companies a little later than I think the kind of venture companies that you're typically addressing. They're companies with earnings, in our case, anywhere from usually $2 million to $20 million. And they are usually run by their founders or founding team or some part of the founding team, along with other investors and managers. And they are usually looking for some kind of liquidity event. And we help them to find the right party to work with and to do a transaction with and to develop the highest value for the company so that they're confident that it's the right transaction for them to do. We're not principals, we're agents. People hire us and they pay us fees.
Great, great. Yeah, as you said, my experience has been with early stage startups, being a founder, being an angel investor, and getting those companies, I think the ones I'm interested in, how they're going to impact the value chain within sort of corporates. So it's that progression of how they build their businesses and that. So one of the areas I want to get your perspective on is when a founder gets to that point, if they've built up $2 million, $5 million of sort of revenue, how do they have to change their behavior and thinking about the venture to get them ready for that, for a liquidity event, as you said, either an M&A or a, you know, complete sellout or an IPO? What's your perspective on how the chief executive and the team needs to change their thinking?
Well, it's not 2 million to 20 million in revenue. It's 2 to 20 million in profit.
All right, good. Yeah.
So that's an important distinction there.
Yeah, very much so. Yeah.
And I wouldn't say they need to change their thinking. I think the thinking that they have early on is the appropriate thinking for them to have. Now, let's talk about what that thinking should be. What is the, how should they build their business from the foundation up? Well, there has been a tendency because of the ease of raising venture money in the last 10 years to think about growth and market share as opposed to profits. And that we've seen that many times before in my career, and that always comes apart because at the end of the day, you know, giving away a dollar or selling a dollar for 99 cents is never a good business in the long run. There are pockets of opportunity in market cycles where that becomes valuable, but in the long run, that's never valuable. So thinking about building a business for the purpose of earnings, not immediately, but when your business has high growth and profitability, that's the hardest thing to build, and that is the most valuable. So focusing on those two things is what businesses at venture stages and at more mature stages need to be thinking about. Yeah. And I would say, you know, so many decks that I see of venture level firms have a slide or two on their eventual exit. Investors I talk to differ on whether that's appropriate or not. Should there be some thought given to how you exit? Some people say, yeah, I want to know where I'm going. And others say that if you focus on building it, it's a distraction to think about the exit. And I have to say, I'm in the latter camp. I think a founder or an owner's mindset needs to build a business as if they're never going to sell it. Because if you never sell it, you're always going to make the kinds of decisions that are best for the long-term health and growth of the business. And those are the decisions that investors and buyers would like to see. So I think it's a distraction to think about who the buyers are for a startup business, because in 5 years from now, whoever the buyers are for whatever business there is will be different. And I tell my clients when they hire us, they inevitably, everybody asks us, who do you think will buy it? And my answer is, I don't know, and I don't care. What I care about is, can we find the party that will share your point of view about the opportunity in the business, the your ability to get there, and be the party that perceives the highest value in the business? And we don't put our finger on the scale to figure out before we see who that is, because you have to give lightning a chance to strike and an outlier an opportunity to get into the game. Yeah. So we don't predetermine that. But here's what I do know. If you build a business that has high growth and profitability, we can find a buyer for it and they will be out there. And that's a hard thing to argue against.
Yeah, no, I think it's excellent points you're making there, Richard, because I think in where we are within the investment cycle now, the conversations I'm having with founders who are in the fundraising sort of stage is sort of saying, well, look, don't be worrying about who your next investor is. You have to focus on the strategic customers, building your revenue and showing a profitable business model, because I'm sorry, at the moment, follow on investment, you know, at that early stage, venture stage, is becoming a lot more lax. And I was at an AI summit actually this weekend over in Oxford, and a number of the conversations at the dinner table were with some VCs, and it was like, yeah, we haven't got money, and we are interested in finding those businesses that have now got revenue and profitability. And we were contrasting the UK perspective compared to the Silicon Valley perspective, because we've always had, you know, our feet more on the ground about what business you're building than the me being harsh talking about the pyramid selling of the venture capital. Just get the next venture round and get it bigger and bigger and bigger, and then where do we dump it at the end, whether you're profitable or not, being an extreme view. So I think your perspective there at the later stage is very good in that there, I think, for our listeners and that to see. Could you bring the topic maybe onto another area that I've seen you've got some experience in that in and getting at the moment, is artificial intelligence and this wave now of AI that's sort of coming. What's your perspective on it and how it could be used in business or retail and that as well? Because we've got a common contact in Yasmin in society AI. So just interested in your broad view on AI and some specific examples you might have seen.
We are only at the very beginning of the beginning with AI. And it's easy to see now, right now, how decisions that managers make today can be made or assisted by artificial intelligence. What's not as easy to see is decisions that are not made today, that sort of happen to you, that can be assisted or made by artificial intelligence. We're going to get a lot more knowledge and information about what's happening in the world around us that we can't view today, that will allow us to be more determinative about the ways businesses are run. And that, in my belief, is going to change everything. I think it's as important as electricity. I don't know. I don't think those comparisons are necessarily so important, except to say how significantly impactful artificial intelligence will be on the life of virtually everyone on Earth. And it's hard to see exactly where that will happen. When I had a Palm Pilot, I could not see that would lead to having a smartphone that would allow you to summon a car to go to the airport. But these things build on each other, and that will happen. That's a small, insignificant example compared to what artificial intelligence will contribute to every aspect of life. And I don't mean to diminish the risks. There are significant risks to that technology as well. The thing about retail and consumer that I've found, at least in America, is that when it comes to technology, I find every retailer wants to be second. And there's a cultural resistance to change. Of course, humans don't like change. It creates anxiety. We all don't want that. And technology is not well understood by most retail and consumer managers. And so what does that mean for startups? Well, of course, it means that it's harder to convince your prospective customers and clients that they should implement this new technology. But what it also means is that after you convince them, they have to go back and sell it within their organization. They do that without you, and they meet inevitable resistance. And that means that it's going to take more time. And that means that venture-driven businesses and startups need to raise more capital than they could reasonably anticipate, because it's going to take longer to do what they intend to do than anyone could reasonably expect when they start the business.
Yeah.
One of the things I found is that a technology startup is not one business, it's two businesses. The one business is the business to create the technology. But once that's built, they have to build another business that's a marketing organization. And that is a different skill to build and to manage than building a technology company. And the successful ones can do both, or do both. And those are skills they learn. And not everybody can do that.
Yeah.
And those are some of the challenges that we've seen companies experience. And getting through that is really hard.
Yeah. No, I go along with a lot of your points there. I think particularly, you know, we're at the foothills of this application of AI, as we're now sort of seeing the GPT and the machine learning, and as you're saying, you know, how we manage this data and that into knowledge. And I suppose the perspective I put on it is, you know, I went through the dot-com sort of boom and bust late 90s, and the analogy I draw now is when Jeff Bezos started Amazon just selling books in the late 90s, we didn't see, as you sort of talked about there, about how it's going to transform industries and sectors and new ways of service and delivery of products, you know, cloud services and things like that. And I think we don't know yet what the Josephine Bezos is going to do in taking AI and applying it to creating a new industry and sort of things like that. I would also add to your point about the perspective I got on the venture part, as you said, about, you know, there's two parts, there's the technology and there's the marketing. I think there's maybe a third part as well of who are the ones who are going to create the disruptive business models, because it's not just about like a Jeff Bezos who developed a technology and then sold it into a retailer. They changed the business model. And I think it'll be interesting to see who's going to create and use AI to change the business model for an industry, or cuts across industries and sort of stuff like that, because I think that's the potential and disruption we've now got coming.
Those are very hard things to predict. At the time you were describing the creation of Amazon, the largest retailer in the United States was Sears. Not Sears PLC in the UK, Sears Roebuck in the United States. Mm-hmm. Amazon should never have existed. Sears was poised. They had everything. Sears should have been what Amazon is today. They had everything they needed to do it. But Sears doesn't exist anymore. And that can happen to Amazon. But it can happen to anybody. And it would have been impossible to say at that time that Amazon would be what it is today.
Yeah. And the industries that are going to be disrupted by AI are going to be in consulting, law, education, and, you know, retail is one of your sort of areas. It's going
to investment banking.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's going to impact so many different businesses and industries. And as you said, in ways we don't know yet, but those things are certainly going to happen. Have you got perspectives on retail generally, sort of stepping back on how things like food retail, fashion retail, interacting with the customer, physical stores, online? Have you got perspectives around this sort of sector changes that you're seeing in that at the moment?
Well, what I think we're seeing from a high level point of view is that there are basically two ways to conduct retail. One is physical and one is electronic or remote. Each one of those has strengths and weaknesses. And, you know, you can't go online, or it's very hard to go online and have the kind of discovery experience that you can have in a physical store. It's very hard to manage a store and get the kind of data that you can get about your customers' behavior that indicate which products move and which products don't, which product attributes are helpful and which are not, that you can get in a physical store. What we're seeing now is we're taking the strengths of each of those and going like this. We're flipping them.
Yeah.
We're giving each one the strength of the other. That's going to take a lot of time. If you go to a retail trade show, the exhibit floor is all technology companies. There's, depending on the show, there's hundreds or thousands of them. It's impossible for any retailer of any scale to be aware of every possible technology that's available and to integrate them. And so you have to choose your spots. When you do that, you create a Frankenstack. And no matter what happens, it's all going to take a very long time to work out. And retail's in a hurry, because once your competitor does it, you have to do it. And as I was saying before, there's institutional and organizational resistance to that kind of change and implementation. So it's a super complex thing. It's going to take a very long time. It requires different skills than most organizations in retail and consumer have. And all of that is a fundamental reorganizing of what retail has been for a long time.
Yeah. No, I corroborate lots of the things you said there. I've been a co-founder of a retail business called Loan Design Club, and the great entrepreneur who started that, Rebecca Mortar. You know, it was about pop-up stores, about declining high street, declining department stores, and about fantastic brands that have got sustainable and conscious products and that behind them, and bringing those together. But as you said, Richard, this difference between the physical store, where you can get that great experience and interaction with the brands and with the customer, to the online, which I found is just flicking through images, having four items dispatched and sending three or four of them back. You know, that's sort of a broken model and that as well. So I'm hoping that this, things going back to our AI discussion, can help to bridge that bit, that you get the interaction, you get the discussion, you get the engagement with the customer, which is quite different than what you have with that experience of that at the moment. But I know, you know, Rebecca and Yasmin and others that I know are working really hard in this sort of space to try and crack that. But as you said, it's a long journey to discover those things and test the technology and test the marketplace.
It's absolutely right.
Yeah. Richard, it's been fantastic speaking with you. I think we've trotted through quite a lot of areas there around how you build your business for exit and liquidity sort of experience, what's happening in AI, what's happening in retail and all that. So thanks very much for sharing your stuff. You've got some great content, which we'll put into the notes and that for this discussion, that people can follow you on LinkedIn and see the great stuff you're writing on Forbes, etc. So thank you.
Andrew, it's great to see you and great to chat. And thank you so much for having me.
Please do give us a 5-star like and follow us for future interviews.